42 in your hymnal number 42, saved by the blood of the crucified one. Glory, I'm saved. Let's all stand together and sing number 42 together. Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved, saved. My sins are all pardoned. My guilt is all gone. Saved, saved. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. On that third, saved by the blood of the crucified one. The Father, he spake and his will it was done. Great price of my pardon, his own precious Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved, saved. My sins are all pardoned. My guilt is all gone. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. All hail to the Father.
All hail to the Son.
All hail to the Spirit, the great three in one. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Glory, I'm saved. Glory, I'm saved. My sins are all pardoned. My guilt is all gone. Glory, I'm saved. Glory, I'm saved. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one.
Well, aren't you glad you're saved? Man, I just thought, isn't that great to sing that song and to mean it? That I'm saved, my sins are all gone, my guilt is all gone, my sins are forgiven, my name's written down in heaven. I don't have to hope I'm saved or think I'm saved or wish I was saved. I know I'm saved. And boy, it's good to sing that. Great song. Good singing. Good to see you back in church tonight. Let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We're thankful for another opportunity that's ours to gather together here this evening. Thank you for each one that's made their way to church tonight. And Father, we pause here and we bow before you. Lord, thank you for a great salvation. Thank you, Lord, that you made it so simple for us. We could just simply accept the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. And Lord, we realize that that gift, free to us, cost you your only begotten Son. And Lord, we realize the great price that was paid for our salvation. And we want to tell you we love you. We thank you that we can sing such a song. It's only by your grace that we're saved. Now, Father, I pray that this service will be what you desire it to be and that you'll use it in our lives, that, Lord, we'll learn some things and be reminded of some things that'll help us to be good soldiers of Christ, better witnesses for thee, better servants, better vessels that you could use in your service. So control this service tonight. Make it exactly what you would like it to be and what you know we need it to be. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
355, 355, wonderful grace of Jesus. Let's sing that first together. Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. Reaches me. Wonderful, the matchless grace of Jesus.
right, listen carefully now. Some announcements and schedule this week. Ladies, tomorrow night is the ladies' night out in the fellowship hall, 6:30 p.m. Consider the leaf. And you got a craft you're going to be doing and good food to eat, great fellowship together. And so if you haven't signed up yet, get your name on that list this evening and have a great time tomorrow night. And then Tuesday night, Grove City School of the Bible, 7 o'clock in the fellowship hall as usual. And then Wednesday for the midweek service right here in the auditorium. And, of course, the Children's Bible Club's meeting as well. Thursday night, we will not be at the prison. I think a couple of the guys don't know that yet, but Chaplain called, and they've had some changes after almost 3 years of just you give you a badge, and once you're in, you just show the badge and you walk in. Now they've changed all that, and they've changed the system, and the chaplain has to come up and walk you back, and he's not going to be there Thursday, so they've canceled RRU for Thursday night. So just wanted to let them know that. And then Friday night, are you here? And ladies going on the retreat Friday and Saturday down to Canal Winchester, you need to just check in with Lindy tonight, would you please? I think she has a message for you. If you're going to ride the bus, they're going to take the white bus down Friday and Saturday. It will leave the church at 5:30 Friday evening, and it'll leave the church at 7:30 on Saturday morning. Okay, so you make sure you know those times if you're going to be taking the bus down to Canal Winchester for the ladies' meeting, which is Friday and Saturday. Don't forget, the registration for voting is out there. If you're not registered to vote, get registered. Okay, it's not a hard process, very simple. Paperwork's down there. Fill it out. And as long as you're good by Tuesday, you're good to vote in the upcoming election. All right, and see to you take care of that. The next Sunday will be old-fashioned Sunday, okay? And we'll look forward to that. And also be in prayer. I think the Morelands leave this week, I think, for a missions conference over in Chicago area. And the Yoders are going to be in a missions conference up at Open Door Baptist Church, where we were for several years before we came down here to pastor. And they'll enjoy that conference. And they're part of that, I think, Wednesday through Sunday of next week. And so be praying for that conference for them. So both of them will be in missions conferences next weekend. And we trust the Lord will be blessing in those areas. All right. And I think that's all I have right now. Let's take just looking around to see if anybody here tonight for the first time, and I don't think there is. So let's hear from the choir, okay?
I boast not of works, nor tell of good deeds, for not have I done to merit his grace. All glory and praise shall rest upon him, so willing to die in my place.
I will glory in the cross, in the cross. Blessed suffering,
413, would you turn with me, please? I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, but love lifted me. 413. On that first all together.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the water lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me.
Good singing tonight. Would you go with me to 212? 212. When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I will praise him. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing? 212. On that first together.
When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing when he said, "Wilt thou be clean?" I will praise him, I will praise him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, O ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain. Though the way seems straight and narrow, all I claimed was swept away. My ambition, plans, and wishes at my feet in ashes lay. I will praise him, I will praise him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Thank you. will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Let's sing that forth together. Blessed be the name of Jesus. I'm so glad he took me in. He's forgiven my transgressions. He has cleansed my heart from sin. I will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain. On that last together, when we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella on the last. Glory, glory to the Father. Glory, glory to the Son. Glory, glory to the Spirit. Glory to the three in one. I will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, all ye people, for his blood can wash away each stain. I will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain.
Great singing. Wow. That doesn't bless you. Your blesser's busted. All right. That's good. Have a seat just a second, fellas. I want Brother Moreland to come up. Brother Ron, if you would. Good things are happening in the 1040 ministry of Brother Moreland, 1040 International. I just wanted to share a little bit about some news that he's received here recently. And then I want, when you get done, you can pray for the offering, okay? All right, Brother Ron.
All right, well, we got some news this morning or this evening on the way in. We were getting off here at the exit, and my wife received a text from Mrs. Schreeder down in Louisiana. If you remember, I had a family come over to Armenia and spend some time with us. And the Schreeders are, he's the pastor. Tom Schreeder is the pastor of Grace Baptist Church down in Zachary, Louisiana. And they spent some time over in Ukraine as missionaries, about 10 or so many so years. And so when they came over to Armenia, they kind of did that as a survey trip, see what the Lord had for their life and what he wanted to do. He's at that point of retirement, but he says, I don't believe Lord wants me to retire. I just think he wants me to change and this or that. So they came over to Armenia, and they got off that plane, and they just took off. I couldn't even hardly keep up with them. And they were just speaking Russian and, you know, just going crazy and just really enjoyed themselves. Well, tonight is the last night of their missions conference down there. So they've asked for prayer as they're going to tell their church that they're going to leave and go back to the mission field. And they're praying about coming over there and spending it with us. Amen. And Brother Tom will be taking care of the Bible Institute that we're setting up over there and helping us plant the churches and training those ministry teams. And the people just love him and Linda to death over there. So if y'all pray for that church tonight, because it is hard when you fall in love with your pastor, and then he says he's going to the mission field and so forth. But this is a man that's still searching and still seeking for the Lord's will. And I just know there'll be a terrific blessing to us and to those people over there. All right, so men, we'll pray and... Our gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this evening, Lord, that we can come in your house freely and worship you freely. Lord, I ask tonight that you'll bless this offering, bless it in abundance, Lord. And also tonight, Lord, I just ask that you be with the preacher as he preaches your word. Speak to our hearts tonight, Lord, that we'll go out of these doors changed. And Lord, we just thank you for the many things that are happening within the walls of this church and even on the outside of the walls of this church, Lord, for the glory and to magnify your name. Lord, we love you and we thank you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
I'd like you to take your Bible this evening, if you would, and go to Acts chapter 26, please. Acts 26 for our scripture reading. We're going to read the first three verses of Acts 26. We'll read one together. I'll read verse 2 and then verse 3 together. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word. Begin together on verse 1 of Acts 26. Ready? Then Agrippa said unto Paul, Thou art permitted to speak for thyself. Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself. I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day before thee, touching all the things whereof I am accused of the Jews. Especially because I know thee to be expert in all customs and questions which are among the Jews. Wherefore, I beseech thee to hear me patiently. And let's pray. Father, I pray you add your blessing to the reading of the scripture here tonight. And Lord, thank you so much for already what we've heard and what we've been able to sing about tonight. And Lord, it's just great to be in the house of the Lord. It's great to be with the people of God. Thank you for Sunday night church. And Lord, we're anticipating you speaking to our hearts tonight through your word. And I pray, Lord, that you will continue to prepare our hearts, that it'll be good ground that the word of God will fall into tonight. Bless the special now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my fallen soul. He looked beyond my fault
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer. Lord, we thank you again for the opportunity we have to open up your word together. And I pray, God, that you would minister your word to our heart tonight. The truth that we have this evening, Lord, I pray you'll help me to be clear. I help, Lord, that it would be a encouragement. It would be something that would greatly help the people of God. And that, Lord, we would understand the great truth behind what Paul said as he stood before Agrippa to give an account of himself. So help us as we look at your word tonight, and please help each individual as they listen. May your will be done in each one of our hearts and lives. And I'll thank you for it. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, according to the World Happiness Report, didn't know there was one, did you? The United States, one of the economically richest countries in the world, came in at number 15 on the happiness scale. It's based on a question about whether people are satisfied with their life. Particularly, they asked the ladder question, L-A-D-D-E-R, ladder, that, you know, from zero being the bottom and 10 being the top, what's the best life you can imagine and where's your life at right now? And 14 other countries came in higher on the ladder than what the United States did. The Gallup International did the survey. And don't answer out loud, but just think to yourself, where would your life be? Where would you place your life on that ladder? What rung would you be on? And as you think about that, and you think about where Americans are on that ladder, I thought about the answer certainly can't be more money, because we have more money now than we ever had before. And people are making more today than they ever had. I was reading or listening this week to someone who was rattling off statistics of life in the United States 100 years ago, 1916 compared to 2016. And if I remember correctly, the average wage per hour was 22 cents an hour. That's what you made as an average wage. And I think most people here make a little more than that now per hour. Can't be more money. It can't be better clothing, for we have more clothes now than what we ever used to have. We have next Sunday's old-fashioned Sunday, and you used to be, when you went to church, you wore your Sunday best or Sunday go-to-meeting clothes. It wasn't a choice. What will I wear this Sunday? That was your Sunday clothes, and that's what you wore every Sunday. So it can't be clothing. It can't be pleasure, because we have more toys and hobbies and sports now than we ever had before. We have microwaves to cook our meals in under 3 minutes. We have washing machines that will wash our clothes all by themselves. And then we'll put them in a machine called a dryer, and it dries them all by themselves. And I know, ladies, that if anybody ever came up with a folding machine, then they'd be very, very wealthy. Because you sure like to have that laundry folded as well, wouldn't you? Push-button phones. I remember, most of you remember when you used to have to dial it around or stick the pencil in there and dial it around. And zero all the way around or nine. Nine, it was cool when you could finally press buttons. And now you don't have to tear the phone out of the wall. You just carry one in your pocket. You take it around with you. And if you don't have a computer, that's all right. You can use that phone as a computer. Look up things and see, it's amazing. We have all the modern conveniences you can think about, and yet we're not happy. We're not happy. Then we come to Paul in Acts chapter 26 as he comes before Agrippa. Now, I want you for a moment to put yourself in, almost said Paul's shoes, but he probably had sandals. But put yourself in his sandals for a minute. You've been arrested for doing nothing more really than praying in the temple. You've been charged with a capital offense of which you're completely innocent. And you've been unjustly imprisoned for 2 years. And now you finally get a chance to tell your side of the story. You finally get a chance to stand before somebody who can do something about your situation. Would the first words out of your mouth be, "I think myself happy"? That's amazing. Now, the first words I think most of us would say, you might say, "I think myself mad," or "I think myself sad," or "I think myself mistreated," or "I think myself a victim of liars who've conspired to lie against me." But Paul wasn't it. He never talked about being mistreated. He never talked about being a victim of any kind. His confession was, "I think myself happy." Now, he's happy because he can answer for himself finally. He's happy because he gets to answer to Agrippa, because he feels like Agrippa, and there's a whole story behind that, but he was very aware of the Jews' religion and what the Jews believed. So he's standing before Agrippa, who, by the way, has the power to set him free. They end up having a kind of a council, and they're trying to figure out what to do with Paul, because they don't really understand what crime he's been accused of, and they certainly can't see where he's guilty of anything. Agrippa and Felix end up talking to one another, and they come to the conclusion that Paul's not guilty, but because of the angry mob that's there, and they decide, "Well, you've appealed to Caesar, so we can't do anything. You're going to go to Caesar and get your case heard before him." Now, it's amazing that his four words that come out of his mouth, and I understand the context of them being he can answer before Agrippa, but I'd like to isolate those four words if we could for this evening. And I think there's a great truth there. In those four words, "I think myself happy." I think myself happy. I wonder what Agrippa thought. As he stands there, has the king on his throne, here's Paul, been a prisoner for 2 years, chains hanging from his wrists, chains around his ankles, bound, prisoner, and he tells him how happy he is. That he thinks he's a happy man. I wonder, no wonder, earlier one of them said, "Yeah, I think you're mad. I think you're crazy. I think you've lost leave of your senses." Do you know that if he doesn't respond properly to these authorities, he could get even more prison time? They have that authority to do that. But he says, "I think myself happy." Now, I want to relay something to you tonight, church. You can think yourself happy. You can think yourself discouraged. You can think yourself sad. You can think yourself depressed. You can think yourself happy. When I think I'm not enjoying life like I ought to enjoy life, the place I need to go to is, what have I been thinking about? Because thinking determines living. Thinking determines living. Happiness is not just an emotion, it is a choice. It is an attitude towards life. Paul didn't look at himself in any particular predicament. He didn't think that he was in a bad place. He was always looking to God. He was always looking to the God of the circumstances and not the circumstances. He was trusting God to lead him and provide for him and take care of him. And listen, you can always look at the cup as half full or half empty. You can always look at the cup, by the way, or you can look and thank God you even have a cup to drink out of. It all depends on how you want to look at it. You can choose to think about your weaknesses or what you don't have, or you can choose to thank God for what He has given you and be grateful for what you do have. You don't have to see the thorns on the roses. You can still thank God for the roses. Amen? Now, I'm just going to give you some very practical principles this evening that is going to help us to think ourselves happy, to help us with our thinking so we can think ourselves to be happy. And the first one is this: I want you to think today and not tomorrow. Think today and not tomorrow. Matthew 6:34, Jesus said this, "Take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought of the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." What did the psalmist say? "This is the day the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." This is the day. Today is the day. Jesus would not, now listen, Jesus would not warn us about worrying about tomorrow and not today if it wasn't a problem with us. So he must know that's a problem. Did you know that they say that 90% of the things we worry about never happen? 90% of the things we're concerned about never take place. So that Jesus says, don't take your thought for tomorrow. You know, our problem is, we always seem to be looking ahead to something else. Let's see. Where's Caleb? He's already out, huh? Okay. Buy this CD. He'll go to bed every night with it. I was going to use him in illustration, but I won't use him now. Let's see. Who can I use? Isaac? I'll use Isaac. There we go. Come up here, Isaac. Isaac, what grade are you in? Third grade, okay. Now, how many of you remember when you were in third grade? Anybody remember third grade? Yeah. You know what you are when you're in first grade, second grade, third grade, elementary school? You know what you look forward to being in? Sixth grade. Why? Sixth graders were the big boys. Hey, I'm king of the elementary school when I'm in sixth grade. Come on, huh? I want to be a sixth grader. So then you get to be sixth grade, and man, you've made it. You've made it to the pot at the end of the rainbow, the pot of gold there at the end of the rainbow of elementary school. But does a sixth grader feel that way? No. Why? They want to be eighth grader. Why? That's the top of junior high. I want to be an eighth grader. And they start looking up to the eighth graders. And when they're seventh graders, and they finally get to be eighth graders, now I'm the king of junior high. Hey, I've made it. Is that what they feel like? Uh-uh. What do they want to do in their eighth grader? That would be high school. Now you'll start looking at the seniors. I want to be a senior. And all through high school, you can't wait till you are the top dog, to where you're the senior class. We are the mighty, mighty seniors. Remember those days? Huh? But were you happy then? No. Because why? Then you want to go to college. Then you start looking at college people. And you go to college and you think, well, now I've arrived. Now I'm going to be happy. Now I've made it. And then you're not happy in college, are you? No. Because guess what? You know what? He looks around and he says, no, I want to get married. He's not so convinced yet, I guess, huh? I want to get married. Oh, he's excited. And so he has to find a girl to marry. Okay, that's the way it works. Finally, the day comes and he sees the bride coming down the aisle. Here comes the bride. I got news for you. Some other things are coming too, okay? And now I'm going to be happy. I'm married. Remember those days? And then you found out bills start coming. And you find out two don't live as cheaply as one. That's just what you thought. But it's not reality, is it? And then one day, just you're trying to scrape to make ends meet, and you're just barely making it paycheck to paycheck. Your wife says, you know, I've kind of been feeling like I got the flu. And you say, oh, well, just, you know, we'll take some NyQuil. She goes, no, I think it's the 9-month flu. And you say, a baby! We're going to have a baby! How exciting! Huh? Oh, and you think, now we're going to be happy! Huh? Now it's going to be good! Hey. Then you have the baby and you find out you forget about ever sleeping at night again. Huh? Every 2 hours, every 3 hours, you're up and the baby's crying and you're changing diapers and you're Hopefully mom is nursing and you can just hand her off or him off. But if not, you're fixing bottles, getting things ready. Oh, I tell you. And you don't want to know what a good night's sleep is anymore. Hey, and people go through life like that. Never happy. Always thinking about tomorrow. I'm going to be happy then. I'll be happy then. First grade, I'll be happy when I'm in sixth grade. No, I'll be happy when I'm in eighth grade. No, I'll be happy when I'm a senior. No, I'll be happy when I'm in college. No, I'll be happy when I'm married. No, I'll be happy when I have children. And it's always tomorrow. Always tomorrow. And they're never happy. Are you happy? Thanks for your help, Isaac. Amen. He never saw his life go so fast as he did tonight, did he? Had him from third grade all the way up to married with kids here in just a few minutes. Listen, this is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. If you're here tonight and you're in third grade, be the happiest third grader there is in the world. If you're in eighth grade, be the happiest eighth grader there is in the world. If you're in 10th grade, be the happiest 10th grader there is in the world. I'm going to enjoy where I am right now. I just want to be the happiest 58-year-old that there is. I know a wave of disbelief just came over the auditorium. You couldn't believe I was 58, but I'm going to enjoy today, not always be looking for tomorrow. Number two, savor today and not yesterday. Just you don't look ahead for happiness, you know what? You can't look behind you for happiness either. Oh, if I could just hear the pitter-pat of little feet again. You better get a dog. Okay? People all the time, oh, if I were just single again. Or, oh, if I still had that job. Oh, if we had kept that house. Oh, if we wouldn't have made that move. But you know, when you're busy thinking about yesterday, you miss enjoying today. You lose out on today. Enjoy today. You know what? Hey, listen to me, kids. You're only a child one time. Enjoy it. One of the tragedies, I think, that has hurt us is, and listen, I love sports, but organized sports is hurting our young people. You know, I wouldn't trade pickup games in somebody's yard or in the lot down the street. I wouldn't trade that for any organized sports they have today. I'll tell you how far back we go. We played tackle football on recess in elementary school. Tackle football. I mean, bust guys in the head, and it was, never thought about it. We just played, and it was rough and tough, and you know what? You get a scratch or you bleed a little bit, you put a Band-Aid on it, and you just say you'll be okay. I wouldn't trade that for any of the organized stuff they have now. Why? You just let them be kids. Kids just come home and play. Come home, and you go outside and play, and you ride your bike until you hear somebody yell dinner time. Until the street light comes on or something, and then you knew you had to go home. So enjoy it. You're only a teenager one time. Enjoy being a teenager. Enjoy whatever stage of life you're at. Learn to enjoy it, because then, listen, when you get to the next stage, when you get to that next level, you know what? You're going to enjoy that too. You're learning to savor the day and not always be looking back behind you. Don't spend your life looking in the rearview mirror. Did you know something? God didn't, I know, kids, don't listen to this, okay? God didn't give you eyes in the back of your head. I know, really, kids, your mom does, but you think they do. But you know what? He didn't intend for us to look. You know what? You can look this way, you can look this way, but you can't swivel your head all the way around back that way. If you can, I don't want to see you. We're not made that way. You know why? We're not wired to look back. We're wired to go forward. So we're pressing toward the mark. And so don't spend your life, Paul said this way, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth to those things that are before. I press toward the mark. So he's telling us that I don't spend my time wishing yesterday. We're different. Our tomorrow we're different. I'm thanking God for today. Think tomorrow. Think today, not tomorrow. Don't savor today, but not yesterday. And then let me give you number three. Enjoy the trip, not the destination. Don't make happiness all about the destination. Now listen, we have a great destination. Amen. You know what? We're going to heaven one day. Okay? That is phenomenal. We can't begin to imagine how beautiful that's going to be. There's some beautiful things on this earth that the Lord spoke into existence in 6 days. I can't imagine what he's got going after 2,000 years. Pretty amazing. It's going to be an amazing place. I understand that. But you know, I don't want to just put all my happiness in the destination and not enjoy the trip getting there. And I don't believe the Lord has that for us. You know, he desires, he said, I've given you all things richly to enjoy. He's, you know, as a parent, you begin to understand things. You know, as a parent, you begin to understand God a lot better. You know why? Because you have children. And as you see your children enjoy themselves and laugh and have fun with one another, you know what that does as a parent? That warms your heart. You're just pleased that they're enjoying each other and enjoying their life. That's a great thing. And I believe God's the same way. He's made us. We're made in His image. And so He is the same way. You know, years ago when our children were very little, we took a trip across country from Arizona back here to Ohio, and we went as far as we could on old Route 66. That was a blast. We had a great time. We saw things. You know, the interstate's great. You get places faster, I understand that, but boy, you miss a lot of stuff. You don't see much from the interstate. When you get off on the roads, and especially Route 66, we saw the Dalton gang and their hideout, and stopped and saw the Wizard of Oz and the Yellow Brick Road and all this stuff. It was fun, and we had a blast with the kids. We weren't just, hey, we were looking forward to the destination of getting back to Ohio and seeing family, but we enjoyed the trip. We enjoyed the trip till we all woke up from a nap and Mrs. Slabaugh had driven us into Mammoth Cave and was so excited for everybody to see Mammoth Cave. We did not share in her enthusiasm, by the way. Nobody sleeps now when she's driving. It's not the destination. It's the journey. I had to learn this. I had to learn this as a pastor. You know, there are, the temptation is the destination. I want to get a church of this many. I want to have a church this big. I want to have this, you know, and I started out, and you know what it is? We need to see this many saved this year, and this many baptized, and run this many in church. And next year, you know what's got to be? More than last year. You know what next year is? More than last year. And every year it's, come on, more. Come on, more. Come on, we got to do more. Oh, come on, we got to have more. You know what I found out? I wasn't enjoying that too much. That's just, when the Lord finally revealed to me, you know what? If you're gonna be in this for the long haul, you might as well enjoy this. And He reminded me that He builds His church. And that it's not me doing that. He does that. And so I decided, you know what? I think I'll just enjoy serving God. And I'm going to get off that treadmill of always more, always more. And by the way, cracking the whip on everybody to do more and to get more. And put you on a guilt trip because you're not doing more. You see, that's not enjoyable for anybody. Nobody long labors under that kind of a scrutiny and that kind of hardship. And so I found out that I wasn't happy. I wasn't enjoying the journey. You know, a great day when you just learn to say, you know what? This isn't my work, it's God's work. God will build his church. God will take care of it. And he's doing it. He's doing it. And I'm enjoying it. Let me give you statement number four this evening. Enjoy happiness within your means. Enjoy happiness within your means. My first car I ever had was a 1969 Volkswagen Bug. Green, by the way. After that, just before we got married, in fact, a month before we got married exactly, my grandfather passed away, had a heart attack, I guess. They were staying in our house, and I remember I was working midnights at the time, and I would in bed sleeping, and it was the afternoon, and I remember my mom calling up. We called my dad's dad, that's my grandfather who was living with us, he and my grandma, we called him Pop. I don't know why, my dad probably called him that, so we started calling him that. So he was just Pop. And I remember her calling up the steps. She's saying, "Stan, wake up, wake up." She says, "I can't wake up, Pop." And he had laid down for a nap on the sofa in our den. And he was reading Lehman Strauss's commentary on Revelation. And that was laid across his chest. And he just was reading about heaven and I guess decided he'd go there. And the Lord said, "Come on up, I'll show you what it's all about." And he went to heaven July 11th, 1979. August 11th, 1979, we got married. And we inherited from him his 1972 Maverick. Hey, it's not a Volkswagen. I was happy, okay? I didn't have to do my own cleaning the inside of the windshield in the wintertime, okay? There's no defrost in a Volkswagen, believe me. There were many a morning in a cold in that Volkswagen. I drove to work looking out the window because you couldn't see through the inside of the glass. Some of you have been there, I can tell. Later on, through her father's help, we got a 74 Buick LeSabre. Boy, that was a big thing. Went to a 78 Chevette. Chevy Chevette. Remember those? And 86 Chevy Celebrity and 88 Cutlass Sierra. But you know what I found out? Oh, by the way, I shouldn't leave out for a time we had a 78 Gremlin. Anybody ever own a Gremlin? Huh? Yeah. That thing was indestructible. I'm not kidding you. It was indestructible. We were parked at church one day and men were doing some work in the parking lot, paving it, I think, and we heard this explosion. Everybody came outside to see what was going on. We had a Christian school there, and all the kids, everybody come out and see what's going on, and there's fire coming up underneath the hood of the Gremlin. One of the workers went over there, and he reached in there. I don't know how he did without burning his hand up, and he popped the hood open, and they got the extinguishers, and you know, put it all out. Don't know what happened. Don't know what blew up. Thing caught fire. I'm not kidding you. Andy remembers it, and my wife's here. They'll testify. I got in the car with the key, turned the key, it started right up. That baby's indestructible, man. I don't know what happened to it, but it wouldn't surprise me if it's still going somewhere. Unbelievable. But you know what? There's never been a car that made me happy. They never made a car that, and by the way, they don't make a car that'll make you happy. They don't do that. Never been a wardrobe that's going to make you happy. They'll never build a house. You'll never build a house that's going to make you happy. The Bible says, godliness with contentment is what? Great gain. You know, many people spend the majority of their life with their heart discontented for one reason or another. Some people are discontented because they don't have a spouse. Others are discontented because they do have a spouse. It's true. Some are discontented because they don't have a job, and others are discontented because they do have a job. Some are discontented because they don't think they have friends, and others are discontented with the friends they have. We get discontented with so many things. We get discontented with church, get discontented with the pastor, get discontented with the deacons. And that's why folks end up jumping around, going church, church, church. There are some folks who, and I'm not mentioning names or hurt anybody, but there are some folks who I know that tried this church when we first came, because you always try the new guy on the block, you know, and check it out. And there are some people that I know just in the 11 years that we'll be here in a couple weeks that are now in their sixth church since we've been here in 11 years. See, that spirit of discontentment, of never being able to enjoy what you have. You know, happiness stems from enjoying what you have. Learn to enjoy what you have. Learn to enjoy within your means. Enjoy the car you have. Enjoy the home you live in. Enjoy the clothes that you have and the friends that you have and the church you attend and the children God's given you and the spouse He's given you. Well, we had four statements so far. Think today, not tomorrow. Savor today, not yesterday. Enjoy the trip, not the destination. Enjoy happiness within your means. And let me give you number five. Stay where you are. Stay where you are. A couple weeks from now, we'll mark 11 years. Boy, I can't believe that. I really can't. And I just thought I'd let you know, we're not looking to go anywhere. Not desiring to go anywhere. Not looking for a better offer. Not looking for greener grass. Why is that? I'm happy. I'm happy. You learn to stay where you are when you think yourself happy. If you don't think yourself happy, you become discontented with where you are. And you think that running here or going there is going to be the new place. That's going to be the happy place. But you find out when you get there, whatever was bothering you back there is there to greet you at your new place. Somebody was having problems with somebody at a job. Say it was, I'll just say is, this guy was having a problem. We'll just say his name was what? Methuselah, okay? He said, I just can't stand Methuselah. You know what? He's going to quit his job because he can't stand that guy. You know what the problem is? The next job he goes to, there'll be a Methuselah there too. And you leave that job and go to the next job, there'll be a Methuselah there too. I remember about 8 years ago, we had discussions. In fact, it was when Pastor Lapish was retiring at Central Baptist Church over here. Some of you were here at that time. And they had discussions with us about combining the two churches. A lot of different things went into that. And by the way, one thing you ought to know, that one reason we knew it wasn't something we should do is they have debt and they're indebted on their property. We aren't. We don't owe any money on this property and on these buildings, even on the renovation. The things that we do, we've paid for. And that makes me happy, by the way. And praise the Lord for that. And listen, I might. You say, well, if that would have worked, you know, you have to look at it and say, well, you know what, I might have been happy there. But here's what I know. I am happy here. And this is where we know that we're happy. And I think the Lord has borne out we made the right decision to stay where we are. You see, by staying here, you know what? I get to see Emma Norman grow up. Okay. Emma, how old are you? 12. You were one something when I came then. I get to see the Barham children grow up. There's so many things you get to enjoy if you just stay and stay put and learn to think yourself happy. I love old-fashioned Sunday. I even love the fact some of you jumped the gun and dressed old-fashioned this morning. That's all right. I love the hayride and the bonfire and the turkey dinner Sunday. The worker appreciation service coming up. The Christmas dinner at Dear Dutchman. I love their chocolate cream pie. In fact, let's pray and go have some. No. Well, I love the children's Christmas play. I love the choir cantata. I love New Year's Eve get together. I think I just stay right where I am. I think myself happy. I think myself happy. It's a choice. It's a choice you make. Whenever you feel yourself down, whenever you feel yourself getting depressed, whenever you feel yourself getting discouraged, stop and ask yourself, what am I thinking about? Am I thinking about tomorrow instead of today? Am I thinking about yesterday instead of today? Am I thinking about the destination and something out there that I'm going to get to, then I'm going to be happy? Or am I enjoying the trip? Let's think ourselves happy. I'm happy in the service of the King. I'm happy, oh so happy. I have peace and joy that nothing else can bring in the service of the King. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this evening. Thank you, Lord, for our church. And Lord, just a kind of fatherly advice tonight, I guess, from this passage here as Paul spoke that he thinks himself happy. And Lord, our thinking determines our living. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Help us, God, to think the right kind of thoughts. There's people here tonight, Lord, that have they're doing exactly what we talked about. Some of them are not happy because they're always thinking about tomorrow. Happiness is somewhere out there in the future. Are they always looking in the past? They're thinking about things that, what if I hadn't have done that, or what if I would have done this, and what if, and they're looking in the rearview mirror. Lord, I don't know exactly how you've spoken to the hearts of people tonight, but I pray that many people in this room would make the decision. I'm going to ask God to help me to think myself happy. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I wonder how many folks here this evening would say, "Preacher, the Lord has spoken to my heart tonight. This is a battle I have. Thinking. I don't think like I should think. And I'm going to ask God to help me with my thinking. Because I want to, and I should, think myself happy. And I'm going to ask God to help me to do that. And I'm going to follow these principles that you gave out tonight as a device. And by the grace of God, I want to live them out in my life. Pastor, pray for me this evening. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, Pastor, pray for me tonight. Amen. Amen. That's good. Praise the Lord. You may put them down. In a moment, we'll pray. We'll have our invitation. It's a time for you to respond to what God has spoken to your heart about. Bow the knee. Ask Him to help you. Ask Him to guide you. Ask Him to help you with your thinking. He will. Heavenly Father, Bless this invitation time. I thank you for speaking to our hearts tonight. Thank you for decisions that have been made for you. May your will be done now in these next few moments. Hear our prayer we make. And Lord, I pray that no matter what our circumstances are, no matter where we are, no matter what is happening outside of us, we'll be happy because of what's going on inside of us. And I pray, Lord, you'd help us to think ourselves happy. So have your way now in this invitation. I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing the invitation. The Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to him tonight, will you please?
With my whole heart, I humbly seek you. Now use my life, O Lord, I pray.
Amen.
I yield my stubborn will completely. May your commandments light my way. My life, Lord, is yours to control. I give you my heart and my soul. I'll seek your will, never mine. Rich treasure to find. Give wisdom to choice as I make. Along every path that I take. So when I complete life's race, well done you will say. Your word has promised me the victory, and all I need to do is claim. Your strength to soar with wings as eagles, to walk, to run, and not to faint. My life, Lord, is yours to control. I give you my heart and my soul. I'll seek your will, never mine. Rich treasure to find. Give wisdom to choice as I make. Along every path that I take. So when I complete life's race, well done you will say.
Father, we bow before you in prayer now this evening. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts tonight, for meeting with us. We are so thankful you're our God, that we are your people. It's been so good to be in the house of the Lord today. Thank you for the people of God who you assemble in this place. And Lord, I pray as the Queen of Sheba came to see Solomon's servants, she was so impressed with how happy they were. They were happily serving the king. And Lord, would you help us to serve you happily? Would you help others to see that this is not something we have to do, this is something we get to do. And we're happy serving our King and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So help us, Lord, to think ourselves happy. As we started Sunday school this morning, let this mind be in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. And Lord, I pray we'd realize that we can plan, but we're ultimately yielded to your plan. You will help us in our thoughts to think ourselves happy. We love you. Thank you for a good day with the people of God. Lord, busy week this week, something happening almost every night. Be with the ladies and the School of the Bible on Tuesday, our service Wednesday, the RU program Friday, Saturday morning at London, the ladies retreat Friday and Saturday, the soul winning and bus visitation on Saturday. Lord, the missions conference that both the Morelands will be traveling to, and then the Yoders. Lord, watch over them, give them safety, and allow them to be a blessing in those conferences, Lord. I pray that both those churches will take these folks on for support. You'll continue to send them on their way. Lord, we love you. Thank you for all you do for us. Dismiss us now with your care and your blessing. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it together, all right? Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in His army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.